looking trouble. Phenomenal running, and he won it anyway light. So Steve Ovett joined such great runners as Sydney Wooderson, Roger Bannister, Brian Houston and John Witt, who've all won European titles.
I was proceeding in an easterly direction, and I just happened to look up at that sign. I don't know why, it just caught my eye. And of course, like an idiot that I was watching that and not watching where I was going, come along and just literally went smack into there. That meant that I went forward and eventually ended up on my back.
Tighten up there now. There you are, you see now this is most remarkable. I think what happened is that you split the tendon and, we have to see what the physical medicine specialist has to say about that.
So you think I'm a star then, Bert, do you?
This was the story in yesterday morning's papers. The headline, the Covey-Ovett showdown. The first time these two rivals have met since Moscow, and that'll be nearly 2 years. The story this morning is radically different. At 10 o'clock, Steve Ovett went into the operating theatre. The surgeon was cutting into the muscle just above his knee.
How long did you say you got being plaster for?
A couple of weeks, I think.
A couple of weeks?
Certainly it means 2 weeks in plaster. It means a further 6 weeks after that, building up the muscle before he'll be fit enough again to even start to take on the burden of training that he needs if he's going to face Co. It's a hard haul ahead of him.
Right, that's it.
Keep the sticks just a little bit further apart, and then you've got sufficient room to get through. Yeah. Okay. Actually, slow it down a bit. Take smaller steps.
Yeah.
That's better. Yeah.
Quite a long ward, this one.
It is.
I'll do it in the morning, so I'll record it as mileage.
So remember, don't let your sticks get too close together.
Yeah. This plaster must weigh quite a bit, does it?
Yes.
So when you're swinging it through, it's quite a weight to control, isn't
it? That's right. Yeah, I expect you'll get used to it, but it won't be on for long, will it?
No, hopefully.
Okay, let's turn around carefully.
Is there any special way of turning?
Yeah, try not to swivel round. Walk round with the sticks.
What, around like that?
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. Something inside of me knows that next year will be my best year. I don't know what the hell it is. It's strange.
Take as much weight as you can on the leg.
I just know that next year will be better than I've had before. It's a feeling, an intuitive feeling that I've got. I mean, I've always worked on sort of understanding myself. You have to in training. You have to know yourself and your body and what it needs and what it doesn't need to a fine degree. I think that understanding heightened the intuition to a certain extent. It'll put me back 2 months. It won't stop me.
I know it's rather boastful, but I've won every major championship now in athletics. I mean, it would have been quite upsetting if it had been before the Olympics. I've won an Olympics, 2 medals at the Olympics. I've won European, 3 medals at the European. Won 2 World Cups, won almost every other major championship in athletics. It's no great sweat to me now if I miss a year. But I won't. I mean, I can feel that now, sense it now. Something inside of me says that it's not sort of preordained, but something is sort of meant to happen this way, really. Gives the other runners a chance, doesn't it?
So Ovett now on the front. There are people he's beaten before, but he's still got to beat them again. And he's pulling away off the front, running in that liquid way he does. 3:48.8 is the time he has to beat. And it's going to be Ovett who wins. There it is, 3:49.24. Just a tantalising half a second off his own world record.
Actually, I think he'd probably be very pleased with that. Because if he can run 3.49 like that, then he must be capable of 3.48. And surely the only time it can happen is when he meets Coe.
It's been okay while it's been in plaster, no problems. Just a bit awkward. The operation has healed quite well, but there's still a lot of hardness around the actual operation, so that's causing a certain amount of immobility, which means I can't really bend it more than that. So that's very, very painful. And what I've got to do is keep exercising that movement until it gets something like reasonable. So it's another couple of weeks, I'm afraid, of exercises, and then maybe, hopefully, in 3 weeks' time, back to training. So it's been, you know, quite a performance, really.
Right, pins and needles coming up. Tell me as soon as you feel it.
Yeah.
That's on the way. Going up a bit. How's that?
That's fine, yeah.
Let me know if it's uncomfortably strong. It needn't be torture.
Ouch.
Is it too strong? No, okay.
I should be lighting up half of Brighton seafront lights.
There's a bit off. I'm a kind man.
Yeah. That hurts again, by that way.
Does it?
Yeah.
Okay. Back up there. That's nice. Straight raise. Lower. Again. Lower. The square. Up. Out. Down. In.
That's quite difficult, actually.
Okay, is it?
Yeah, on the abductors.
A little bit of coordination comes in.
Yeah.
Both together. Again. That's fine. Have a blow.
So how often do that? I can't do that all day long. Every so often. Whenever I can.
Now then, sit over the side. Raise. There again. Get your foot back to 90.
Yeah.
Again.
There's no point in going any further back with the flexation than, you know, beyond 90.
None at all. Now, a few free swings.
Just loosely plop about. It doesn't feel too bad.
That's fine.
To describe how the leg feels. The knee feels a bit like when you catch it on the table. A bit numb and slightly sore. I think I'll have to gonna give it another few hundred yards to see if it warms up a little bit. Breathing quite heavy after 200 yards, which is quite unusual for me. Thank God there's no big races coming up this weekend. Still, we're only going to the pier and back, so should be quite a safe journey today. There's a dull ache, obviously, but I think that's to be expected. The fact that I'm absolutely shattered is another thing that I'm expecting. But at least I'm plodding on, which is a progression from sitting down at home all the time. And it's nice to get the feeling of your lungs working. I'm not too sure at the moment how it's going to stand up to any increase in work. At the moment, it's very sore. You don't want to join in, do you? The leg's all right. It's the rest of me that's complaining, yeah. Home is in sight. The big finish. Arrivederci.
I think we first met at Crystal Palace when I was an athlete myself and I was training up there. It's quite funny, I was walking around one corner, he was walking around the other. We literally bumped into each other.
Was it an instant attraction?
An instant attraction. I mean, it took Steve 4 years to ask me out. I think 4 years to ask somebody out would definitely make them a shy person.
You must have to do some interesting people there, don't you, for this programme?
Well, all sorts, yeah.
And we've got a real scoop today, because in the hot seat is someone who would normally run a mile to get away from press interviews, and CBTV Channel 14 has actually managed to get him into Studio 3 for this week's press conference. He's one of the world's greatest ever athletes, some would say the greatest, and if you need another clue, here he is coming up to the tape at Oslo.
Too much. He looks too relaxed at this stage.
Yet he's a tenth of a second faster than Cole was at the 1500 metre mark. It's all down to this last 80 metres now, and he's staying with it. But he looks so relaxed, it's going to be desperately close. 3:49, the time to beat. And he's inside it. 3:48.8. Ovett takes the world record from his greatest rival, Sebastian Coe.
Do you find it a strange to be competing against Sebastian Coe, even when you're not actually racing with him?
It is a strain because, obviously, in this country, when you have two world-class athletes, everybody wants to sort of pair them off and to see who's the best out of either one or the other. So all the time in the press you read about when are we going to meet and if we're going to meet and is it going to be in this race or is it going to be in that race. So all the time you're continually sort of being pressurised by the media about the situation. But I think, really, it's not that much of a problem. We both get on with the job of running and enjoy it to the best of our abilities.
How do you feel about people saying that you're unfriendly to people like the press?
I think it's very difficult. You can't please all the people all the time. And the press tend to sort of change their attitudes with the wind, really. The one minute they're calling me a bad boy if I don't sort of go and give them interviews, and the next minute they're saying what a wonderful runner he is and he's a real lad, you know, and all this sort of thing.
What did the Queen actually have to say to you?
One of the things was that I was actually spotted jogging around Hyde Park this morning. I hope they didn't spot me when I was being overtaken by some of the joggers, but... and then she asked me how my leg was coming along, and I told her.
See, I fabricated over a period of years, toyed with the idea of imagery with the media by giving them certain things, not giving them other things. It's been fascinating, I must admit. And so I've created an image which I, in many ways, are quite grateful for, really. It's this bad boy image, this tough, mean, arrogant person that you see on the television, you know, bites chickens' heads off, that sort of thing. And doesn't do a nice thing, you know, and if he does, he regrets it for a week or so afterwards.
Get one more picture, hand in hand with your wife. Just walking at the camera. Can we just show your medal in the other hand?
Please, I mean...
It's just the last one we want, that's all.
OK.
We just show it in the other hand. Put it open or something. That's it. You just hold hands and walk at the camera. Tell you where. Camera, fix the camera. OK, thank you very much.
The only way that I could see of surviving, if I was going to be at athletics at the top level and still remain a fairly sane individual, i.e. not believing in the imagery which they were creating, then I had to detach myself from it. And I saw that at a very early age, 17, 18, really. And that's exactly what I did. I moved away from that sort of field, that sort of area where I could have been swallowed up and quite merrily taken on the bandwagon for about a year or so, 2 years, you know, and been dumped.
Watching Moscow while Steve was away, I had my first taste of the press. As soon as Steve did his ILY sign, the press just besieged our home. I was living with my parents then at the time, which didn't make it very easy for me at all, because they were ringing the bell sort of every quarter of an hour, and as soon as he crossed the finishing line, you know, the doorbell was there and they were there with champagne or whatever, and it was a very difficult situation for me, trying to keep everybody happy.
OK, well, how much film have you got left?
One more kiss. One more kiss.
What do you think? Yeah, it's good.
On the cheek. That's the one.
OK.
I don't bother about the media, really. I just get on with living and enjoying myself, and that's the most important thing. I'm not really, when you say superstar image, I don't really believe there is any such thing as a superstar if the person doesn't want that. It depends on what you want to assume and what you don't want to assume.
I think he was kind of born to run. He's got that, he's got a terrific attitude towards races. You know, he's got a kind of killer instinct. I think all the other kind of world-class athletes are frightened of him. You know, a lot of them will run for second place when they know Steve's in the race. Even in his training, he can be ruthless. He won't let me miss a session. Or get halfway through a session, I say, oh, I'm tired. I've got to finish the session with him. So he's ruthless in that aspect.
D, two of them. A, two of them. G minor to A. G back to D. D, two of them.
I said to him, what are you doing for a run? And he says, well, nothing really. So he says to me, shall we go out and run together? I says, yeah, that'd be great. And since then, for about the last 8 or 9 years, we've just trained very much together.
Oh, yeah. You're quite strong.
Yeah. I don't know. I enjoy running. I mean, that's a focal point. It's not the fundamental point of why I take part in the sport. You know, I'm enjoying the challenge at the moment. I'm enjoying the challenge of what most people would consider improbable, i.e. to come back from an operation, a major operation, on my leg and still run respectably, or if not respectably, very well indeed.
When we first started to train together, I kind of thought I'd hold him back, but gradually over the years, you know, that hasn't been so. I think it's helped him. He wants someone who's reliable, who can go out training with him, you know, all types of weather, all times of the year. And I think this is what he needs. I mean, sometimes if I don't go for a run, Steve won't go for a run.
Back to G.
I would probably say he's about 60% fit at the moment. But this time of year is a kind of transition time anyway. And this is a time when he starts doing the speed work. He's curtailed that to a certain extent because the thigh of the leg is just not strong enough to take the hard type of work that he does this time of year.
Trouble with Brighton is it's full of hills. You're not going up when you're coming down, man. That's why I'm not much good on the flat.
How do you feel then? Stiff?
Yeah. Yeah. Sort of, you can see it, you know, I can feel that I'm running sort of with an imbalance. But what can you do, you know? Time is running short.
My family situation isn't any different than most people when they get married. You do have an awful lot of upheaval because you are starting a new life. As I say, my sort of family framework broke up. I was living on my own then and not in the family system, in the family setup. That is difficult to get used to when you've been there all your life, where you're almost the centre of attention in the family because you are an important person to them. In other words, they like to sort of do their best for you. And then, as I say, that sort of, that changes completely and you are on your own. You have to do your own you know, sort of simple things like washing and getting things sorted out, which is, I know it sounds quite sort of menial, but it is very important that you have to do all these things. that sort of shock of being, you know, having everything done for you to, you know, having to do it all yourself, takes a little bit of getting used to. And I must admit, for the first 3 or 4 months, I was a bit sort of haywire, but then you settled into a routine, and I quite enjoy it now.
I think our situation's changed, both of us. I mean, when we first met, I was living at home, Steve was living at home, so obviously our lives were very, very different to the fact that they are now, that we're married now, and we live together for a year. So, yes, maybe he has had a change. I think we both have. But, I mean, I think that's natural. I mean, as you get older, you do change. You know, no one stays 18 or 19 or whatever forever. You do just progress.
Rachel. I've seen that here before, this one, haven't I? 227.
Yeah, that was here last month.
Hmm. It's been sold and then resold again, looks like. Perhaps they can't shift it.
One of the nicest things about him is that he is such a great athlete, and yet he's not totally wrapped up in the sport. Not completely. I mean, he's not a fanatic. Not in any way.
I wouldn't say that this sort of collector mania that I've got is something which will last. It was something which Rachel and I decided that we, you know, if we were going to get married, that we would take time in finding things that we loved and finding things that would be with us for the rest of our lives. And we spent a whole year looking for things. And the most enjoyable year it was. But it's not a collector mania in anything like that. It's just filling up your life with things.
I think it's been quite lucky that we moved into the flat and we had lots of things to do, we had lots of things to occupy his mind, you know, all sorts of decorating and household bits and pieces that he just got on with, and I think it took his mind off the whole injury, which was maybe a blessing in disguise. Cars were another big love of his, working on cars. I mean, he's always enjoyed working on different machines and things. He enjoys that very much.
It's going in for its MOT soon, so it needs tightening. But always with these things is you never have the right tool. What I need is a stumpy screwdriver, and what I've got is rather a big one. So you end up grease everywhere and aching arms and limbs with taking a job that would normally take 5 minutes, spreading over a period of days. But I think, with a bit of luck and a bit of brute strength, I've got that.
Well, I enjoy the things that I do outside my sport. I've always worked that way. I've always tried to do the things that I enjoy doing. And also, the other things that I don't enjoy doing, I've tried to work around to a way where, by doing them, I can get some benefit from them. So I tend to live a fairly fulfilled life.
Captain Ovett, he walks on the water.
He's a mean man.
No, but you know, you have to be an official of the BAB before you can start walking on water.
Of course, he's using the muscles now. They're taking down the track at an incredible pace.
and he's actually stopped using the arms. Well done, Steve, not too bad. I think you make a good runner, but forget about the journey. I'll go run a quick 1500 now, okay?
We used to come down here, before I met Steve, we used to have these camps down here. And then Steve came down, and he liked it very much when he was young. And I think ever since then, we've come down at least once a year for a weekend. But generally, he feels that it's a getaway place. You can come down here and train with a bunch of lads. There's no pressure on you. It's a totally different atmosphere. He also regards it as a bit of a testing for his fitness, because it's usually the same time of year when we come down here, so he gets a very good guide from this as to how he's going in comparison to previous years.